Hey everybody, hope you're having a good day. Just wanted to give you some information on the scientific method. Hopefully this little short video will get across the major points of the scientific method that I would like you guys to know. In particular, there are six terms that are really, really important and fundamental to understanding the scientific method. So let's talk about those now. First of all, number one, every scientific study has a control group of samples. And so I'm going to denote that as a CG, control group, okay? There is also another term called the experimental group, okay, of samples. And we'll go into detail about that group of samples as well. The third term that I want you guys to be familiar with is called constant variables, or just constants for short. Some scientists also call these controlled variables. So I can put controlled variables just as another way to say it. But constant variables or constants or constant or controlled variables, they all mean the same thing. Number four is going to be the independent variable. Okay, independent variable. All right, and that's also called the manipulated variable by some scientists. Because scientists choose to manipulate it. And we'll talk more about that in a sec. Number five is called the dependent variable. And this is what scientists measure in an experiment. We'll talk more about that in a sec too. And the last term I want you guys to know is this one called confounding variables. Okay, so confounding variables are ones that often happen or occur in an experiment, and they end up messing up your experiment. So, let's start out with a typical study would set up. Let's take the example of a scientist wanted to investigate whether a fertilizer was good at increasing the growth of plants. Okay, so in a typical study, we'd set up two groups. Okay, so there'd be a group of samples. We'll call this my control group of samples. And here I would have just a bunch of kind of potted plants with here old Jolson bushes, and we'd have replicates of this several pots with this same kind of plant. Okay. And we'd call this the control group of samples. So here's sample one, sample two, sample three. Three different plants. Three is usually a minimum in a real scientific study. And this group of plants would get no fertilizer. So we would sometimes maybe call this the no fertilizer, okay, group. So there's your no fertilizer. And we'd be doing a study to check whether fertilizer is actually working. We'd have to have also a fertilizer group, all right? And this fertilizer group would be my experimental group of samples, okay? And the experimental group, I like to think of this EG as the exciting group, whereas the control group is the ordinary or plain or even boring group of samples. And so in this particular group of samples, I'd have the same pots with the same plant, and everything's the same, okay? Right, and you'd have several of these pots going, minimum of three, with their plants, okay? And so here's one, two, three, and then there was one, two, three over here, but there's something different about these plants, and so let me change my pen to something magical. Inside these, okay, pots, we have something special, and these pots, that would be a fertilizer that is special in there. And so so that would be a typical study. You have one group of samples, this control group of samples, and you'd have an experimental group of samples, and you're comparing in this experiment what happens with the growth of plants. Say you're measuring the height or the weight of these plants, and then you would compare these two groups, and if the fertilizer group grows more than the control group, then you can say that the fertilizer was effective at increasing plant growth. Now, these constant variables or controlled variables, Okay, these are things that we keep the same, okay? So here we have the same. And just going back, sometimes I like to just make this really easy. You know, control group is boring group, and experimental group is the exciting group, okay, of samples, and controlled variables or constants are things that we keep the same. So what are we keeping the same between these two? Again, are my CVs, my constant variables. And that would be like the type of pot, how much water you give to both. Okay, so I'll just write down a couple examples like water, okay, the amount of water, or again, the type of, even the type of plant, the plant that you use, etc., right? You want to make sure you're comparing apples with apples, not apples with oranges, so to speak. So here we have next the independent variable. Independent variable has another name. It's also called the manipulated variable, okay? The manipulated variable is one that the scientist chooses to change. And if you guys know this delta symbol, that's a symbol for change. So I want you to think about, what is the scientist changing, okay, between these two groups? And so looking at these two groups right here, what is the scientist choosing to change? That is what the independent variable always is. What is the one thing being changed between these two groups? And the one thing that is different. The fertilizer, right? So in this particular example, the independent variable is the fertilizer. Okay, so here is the one thing that's differing is the whether we have you could also call this whether we have fertilizer or no fertilizer. So you could call it the plus minus treatments, okay? Some scientists also like to say, okay, it's the amount of the fertilizer that's differing between. Here we have some fertilizer, here we have none. And we have this dependent variable is our next one. And with our dependent variable, I want you to think always, what is the scientist, what is being measured, okay? That's the question you need to ask yourself. What is being measured in these pots? In these pots, what about the plants are we measuring? And it's quite clearly in this particular example, it's going to be the growth, right? So growth is what we're measuring here, and I'll just make sure you know it. And growth, usually scientists don't just measure one plant on this side and one plant on this side. We measure a whole bunch of plants, right? We have a sample size of three or more, okay, on this side, and three or more of these samples, and we end up taking an average. So typically we'd say, okay, this is going to be, for instance, the average growth in, or it could be the average height in centimeters. Sometimes we don't use heights. Perhaps a better indicator of growth might be weight, in which case we, instead of using centimeters, we might use grams, okay? Again, using metric units is very important in science. And finally, we have these things called confounding variables. And confounding variables are variables that that mess up. I'll just write, what could potentially mess up the experiment, okay? And so these are things that mess up your results and confound the experiment. They introduce variability among the replicate samples. And so what can happen is in this particular experiment, you may have, let's pretend you have like a tree, okay? A tree that is in this area where you're doing this experiment. And over here, you have the sun, okay? And the sun represented right there, sunlight's coming down, but it hits a tree, okay? And so the sun actually only ends up hitting these samples, but not those other samples. And so this right here, if these ones are shaded from the sun, they're not going to receive adequate sunlight, whereas these ones do. And you might get a funky result here due to this confounding variable, where your control group without fertilizer grows more just because they weren't in the shade of this tree. So in this example, the confounding variable is the tree's shade cast upon one group of samples and not the other. And anyway, we've now gone over the six terms of the scientific method that I'd like you guys to be familiar with. I hope that was clear and you now understand the scientific method a little bit better. Okay, have a good day.